Hey, you ever want to play your favorite anime character in a tabletop RPG and the system would, you know, kind of let you do it, but not really? Well, then you should play Worlds of Myth. Welcome to MythTube, where we build your favorite anime characters in Worlds of Myth. What is Worlds of Myth, you may ask? Well, Myth is a tabletop RPG that I designed to allow you to build the over-the-top characters you only find in shonen battle anime. Characters like Naruto, Deku, Meliodas, and Ken Kaneki are all examples of characters this game can easily let you build. The game is in late beta right now, so you can head on over to worldsofmyth.net and download a free PDF, and you can also download a variety of other supplements. Yeah, for free! My goal is to spread awareness of the game before its official launch, and I want as many of you as possible to have fun playing it. You can also head on over to our Discord at Sinister Jester Worlds of Myth, where you can talk all things about the game, find a group to play with, or check out some of the other games we're testing. But without further ado, let's talk about who we're building today.
So today we are building Milim Nava from That Time I Got Reincarnated as a Slime. If you haven't seen this anime yet, I would highly recommend it. The show is pretty much exactly what it sounds like, being about a guy from our world who dies and is then reincarnated into a magical world as a slime. Except that he is a super slime, which means he's powerful enough to rub shoulders with our girl Milim Nava, who is probably the second most powerful being on the planet. The show is not as combat focused as some of the other animes I've recommended in the past, but it does have some fun combat along with a super interesting and well thought out world, and some interesting political and social issues, as well as some fun characters and character moments. Again, highly recommend it. Currently, it has 2 seasons out with an 8.4 out of 10 rating on my anime list, and you can find it on Crunchyroll or Funimation. We don't have an announcement yet for season 3, but with how popular the manga is, it is pretty likely. Switching back over to Milim over here, she is one of Rimuru's best friends and holds the title of a demon lord. She is in fact one of the oldest demon lords, with this guy being named Guy being the only one older than her. So super ancient, scantily clad lolly, pretty typical anime stuff. But while she is called a demon lord, that seems to really be more of a title since she doesn't really have very demonic magic. Still, in the world of That Time I Got Reincarnated as a Slime, damn, that's a mouthful. In order to reach the level of power she is at, you do have to gain a demon seed and then sacrifice at least 10,000 lives. And then some actual demons will show up and promote you. So she's got some demonic roots. But what Milim actually is a half dragon or dragonoid at peak power. As such, she is super fast, super strong, and super durable with an incredible amount of magic and firepower at her disposal. She is an excellent hand-to-hand fighter, and when she is really serious, will pull out her legendary blade, Demon Sword Evil God. She can fly, she can teleport, she's immortal, and has super good eyesight that can view a person's magic energy and has great analytical abilities. She also apparently has a pocket dimension for her to store cute clothes and pull out weapons and armor. For magic, she seems to be able to amp up her physical attacks with some kind of destruction magic, and she has been seen to use Drago Nova and the devastating Drago Buster. She also possesses the ultimate skill Wrathful King Satan, in which she grows a horn, a set of wings, and dons her armor and sword. This form greatly increases all of her abilities based off of how angry she is. Now that we've gone over her abilities, let's take a look at how she stacks compared to the other characters in her universe and figure out what level to build her as. So, in Worlds of Myth, there are 6 tiers of power with 5 levels between each, and we will correlate this with the monster ranking system from the show. Tier 1, or levels 1 through 5, is where I'd put F through E ranked monsters and adventurers, characters who are either novice or beginner. Tier 2, or levels 6 through 10, is where I'd put D through C ranks, characters and monsters who are intermediate to strong. Tier 3, or levels 11 through 15, is for B through A rank, which is for advanced or elite characters. Tier 4, or levels 16 through 20, is for hazard class threats. monsters who could potentially cause widespread damage to a town or region. Tier 5, or levels 21 through 25, is for your calamity level threats, beings that could take on an entire country by themselves. Tier 6, or levels 26 through 30, holds the disaster and catastrophe class threats. Disaster class monsters being able to wipe out nations, and catastrophe classes who would be the level 30s, requiring several nations to join together to even have a chance of defeating them. So where does that put Milim? Well, there's not a lot of debate on this one. Milim is implied to be less powerful than Guy, but she is considered a true catastrophe class, so we're building her as our second level 30 on the channel. For our level 1 stats, we are gonna go with that good old anime protagonist spread of 4 speed, 4 power, 4 skill, 1 cunning, and 4 heart. Milim is not stupid. Ditzy, impulsive for sure, but she's not stupid. But we're just gonna start with a low cunning, cause it's naturally gonna get higher by itself, and if she did have a dump stat, it would definitely be her thinking stat. For your race, Milim is a Dragonoid, which is a half dragon, half human, so we're gonna go with Dragonborn. Yay, a non-human build! As a Dragonborn, you get plus 2 power, cunning, and heart. Dragons are kinda the spellcasty powerhouse race. Dragonborn get 2 gene slots, and as a powerhouse race, you get superior being. This grants you plus 5 to your stat caps, meaning you cap at 20 instead of 15. You also get Dragon Scale, which grants you a permanent plus 2 armor, which is damage mitigation. And then you get Dragon Breath, which allows you to use your mouth as a spell hand. This means you can potentially tri-wield spells. But keep in mind that when dual-wielding more than 2 weapons or spells at a time, you have to spend an additional passive action along with whatever other action economy is required of the given attack. Then you get Keen Eyes, Night Vision, and Sharp Nose, which are ribbon abilities that I won't go into too much detail about, but they allow you to see things that are far away, see just fine at night, and smell things really good. Next, you get Aura Sense, which is basically a better version of Myth Sense, which everybody gets. But this allows you to make a cunning versus heart roll in order to figure out someone's current myth, myth total, alignment, level, and even get a sense of their personality and current mood. Then lastly, you get Holding Space Dragon's Hoard, which allows you to store any amount of currency and up to 20 items in your own personal pocket dimension. You can mark an item as yours by spending 10 myth and an hour-long ritual outside of combat, but once it's marked, you can spend 1 myth and no action economy just to make the thing appear or disappear. Dang, man, Dragonborn get a lot of little bonus abilities. For your spell schools, Dragonborn get Bestialmancy, Psymancy, Vitaemancy, Hypnomancy, Hexmancy, Echomancy, Ocularmancy, Spatialmancy, and you get to choose one elemental or spiritual spell school of choice, so long as you don't choose Geomancy. Dragons aren't meant to spit mud attacks. You could also swap this spell school out with Venomancy if you wanted to be like a poison dragon. But the spell school we're gonna go with is Holymancy, since your Dragonova and Buster seem to be energy-based attacks. We could also go with Shadowmancy for that, but Milim seems more like a holy type to me. For talents, you get Haggling or Arcana level 1, we'll go with Arcana. That'll give you plus 5 to rolls to see if you know things about magic-y stuffs. Then, for our talent of choice, we'll go with Investigation / Perception level 1, as you are considered pretty perceptive. This'll give you plus 5 to rolls involved in searching for information or noticing small details. And then finally, for our level 1 kit, we get 5 upgrade points. So we'll get improved skill level 1, and then we'll get monk level 3, she is first and foremost a puncher and a kicker, and then we'll get dodge level 2. This is more or less what I would imagine her level 1 kit would have looked like. Next, we are going to skip all the way up to level 15. We've never known Milim in the show as anything other than the level 30 monster she is, so I don't really have any story beats to go off of. That means that we are just going to take her up to her highest non-epic level and then finish things off by bringing her to max level. By the time you hit level 15, you'll have gained plus 70 HP, plus 140 myth, 2 stacks of overcharge, 73 upgrade points, and 14 stats. We'll go ahead and put 6 into speed and then 8 into skill. As a Dragonborn, you also get another plus 4 power, cunning, and heart. We'll kick things off by getting Mark of Wrath level 3. Think of this as a combination of your temper mixing with that demon seed. This will give us plus 2 power, skill, and heart. It also gives us access to rage counters. We can store an amount of rage counters equal to our heart stat and gain a rage counter every time we are hit by an attack or we ourselves attack somebody else. You can spend stored rage counters in order to gain plus 1 offense, plus 1 defense, plus 2 damage, and plus 1 protection per stack for the duration of one attack or block. You also get the spell Berserk, which allows you to spend 20 myth and 10 rage counters in order to add plus 5 to all of your stats, except for cunning, which gets minus 5, and you surrender control of your character over to the GM, who will then likely use your juiced up character to murder whatever is closest. And to help you in your murder quest, we will increase your monk weapon to level 5 and get dual wield so you can dual wield your kicks with your punches. By this level, a dual wielded monk weapon is one of the best weapons in the game. Next, we'll grab Holy Blast level 5. This will become our Drago Buster later. This is a powerful attack type spell that takes 2 actions to cast, but shoots a 120 foot long, 15 foot wide beam attack. I'm not going to put the number totals here, I'll stick them at the end of the video once all of our stats are done, but for now, just know that this attack has a good chance to hit and good base damage. Also keep in mind that you can spend overcharge stacks in order to add plus 1 offense, plus 20 damage, plus 50 foot range, and plus 10 feet to the width of the blast. Next, we'll also get the beta spell Homing Lasers to represent your Drago Nova. This spell shoots a bunch of lasers that ignore the objects in between them and their target, and also cannot be blocked by someone else using aid to jump in the way of the attack. After that, we need all the stats, because Milam is a terrifying force to be reckoned with in all aspects. So we'll grab Improved Speed level 7, Improved Power level 7, Improved Skill level 6, Improved Cunning level 7, and Improved Heart level 7. And then with a speed and cunning of at least 10, we'll also grab the growth's Godly Speed and Efficient. Together, these growths will give us an extra action each turn. After that, Milam seems to have the ability to juice her attacks up with raw destruction energy, so we'll pick up the spell Holy Strike level 3. For 10 myth and a passive action, this gives all of our attacks plus 12 holy damage until the end of the turn. We'll also grab Elemental Specialist level 2. This will give us another plus 10 damage, so long as we only have one amplification spell active. Meaning that if you activate Holy Strike, you're getting plus 22 holy damage to all of your attacks. And then we'll finish things off in tier 3 by getting Durable and Spiritual level 5. This will give us plus 50 HP and Myth. Moving all the way up to level 30, by this point you get plus 80 HP, plus 160 myth, plus 4 stacks of overcharge, 115 upgrade points, yeah, 115, plus 15 to all your stat caps, and 16 stat points. We'll put 7 points into skill, 6 into speed, and 3 into power. From our race, we'll also get another plus 4 power, cunning, and heart. We'll also get immortal, meaning as long as we aren't killed, we can potentially live forever. First things first, we need lots and lots more stats. So we'll go ahead and grab improved speed, power, skill, cunning, and heart level 15. We'll also go ahead and grab Mark of Wrath level 4, which will give us another plus 1 to all of our stats and stat caps. That'll bring us down to 69. Nice! Next, let's go ahead and master our basic kit with Monk level 6, Holy Blast level 6, which will now really count as our Drago Buster, and Homing Lasers level 6. We'll also get Overflowing Spirit, that'll give us an extra plus 1 overcharge so we can stack up to plus 7 offense, plus 140 damage, plus 350 foot range, and plus 70 feet width to our Drago Buster. Then we'll get Holy Strike level 4 and Elemental Specialist level 3. Together, these will make our Holy Strike give us a boost of plus 35 holy damage to all of our attacks for the turn. And then we've got a lot of heavy myth consuming abilities, so how about we grab ourselves some Wisdom level 5. With a cunning minimum of at least 15, this will allow us to get an extra plus 100 myth. Then you need some sword skill, so we'll pick up Medium Blade level 6, that'll cost us another 7 upgrade points. Then let's get your Milam's Eye more analytical with improved Analyze. By spending an action instead of a passive action, your analysis roll gets a plus 3 bonus. After that, let's get angrier with Intimidation / Rage level 4. This talent will give us plus 10 to rolls to intimidate people. You're cute, but you're scary when you wanna be. This also makes it so we get 2 rage counters whenever we get hit instead of only 1, and it doubles our maximum number of rage counters, meaning we can have a total of 64 at a time. Consider for a moment that if you accumulate 64 stacks and then blew them all in one single attack, which is highly impractical, but let's just say you do it, you could be adding plus 64 to your chance to hit and plus 128 damage. But you know what else is a lot of damage? More overcharge stacks. So we'll just go ahead and grab Charge Up level 2. For 2 actions and 10 myth, you can store an extra stack of overcharge that gets spent on your next ability that can use it. Since you have 3 actions, it's most optimal to use it only once and then use all your normal stacks of overcharge with your next spell, but you can do it up to 2 times. Next, your favorite move is to zip up and punch someone really hard, so let's go ahead and grab Blitz level 1. For 2 actions, you make a movement and a standard attack, but you get to add your speed stat to your damage. You can use this any number of times in a battle, but you can only use it against a single opponent once. Next, we'll go ahead and grab Power Attack level 3. This technique can stack with Blitz, giving you minus 5 to hit, but plus 10 damage, and you knock your opponent back a number of feet equal to how much HP they lost rounded down to the nearest 5. After that, we'll get Focused Attack level 3. This can again stack with Power Attack and Blitz, and will give your attack plus 5 offense and plus 10 damage, which will negate the success roll penalty of Power Attack while making the combo deal our usual attack's damage plus 52. After that, we still need to give her the ability to fly, so we'll grab the Psymancy spell Levitate level 2. At this level, the spell becomes an ability, meaning that it is always on and does not require myth. It allows us to fly, moving up to heart times 10 feet while we are flying, which for us is going to be 320 feet with one action. That's 64 spaces across the board. And then we need to throw away one more upgrade point, so how about Seduction level 1? And it's not because of her obviously skimpy outfit. This'll give you plus 5 to heart rolls when you're trying to use your looks to get your way. We've seen Milam pull out the cute cry face on Rimuru more than once, and while she's not trying to seduce him, she is using her adorableness to try and get what she wants. And with only 15 upgrade points left, we'll go ahead and grab your ultimate skill, Wrathful King Satan, in the form of the Gene Transformation level 3. This gene gives us access to the spell Special Transformation level 3, which for 2 actions and 40 myth gives us a base of plus 4 to all of our stats until the end of combat, and also gives us 15 customization points. These customization points can be spent like upgrade points that we only get while in this form. But more importantly, there are several special upgrade options that the gene offers for us to spend spend these customization points on. Some of these special upgrades can also give us more customization points by applying penalties to your transformation, like Special Condition. Special Condition gives us 5 customization points, but forces us to choose a condition that we have to meet before we can transform. We'll go with Mounting Rage, which makes it so that we have to have at least 10 rage counters before we can transform. With 20 customization points, we'll first grab Magical Might, which makes it so we have another stack of overcharge while in the form. Then we'll go ahead and grab Special Mutation. This'll allow us to pick up another gene while in our transform state, and we'll blow another 10 points in order to pick up half elf level 4 while selecting the Wood Elf subrace. This will give our special transformation form another +1 speed, skill, and heart, access to Botnomancy, which we'll never use, +50 myth, and another stack of overcharge. With only 3 customization points remaining, we'll pick up special speed, power, and skill, which will add another +2 to the corresponding stat while in the form. This means that your transformation bonuses will look like this. And that's the build. So how did we do? Well, spot on if I do say so myself. Milam really got everything you would expect to be in her kit. With overwhelmingly powerful stats, bonkers ridiculous damage focused around single powerful attacks, a powerful ultimate skill transformation, and enough rage to properly represent the battle gluttonous, hot-headed, lightest shade of redhead that you are. We also got some of her fun nuances, like her power of flight, really good eyesight, and even that pocket space for her different outfits. All in all, a terrifying build befitting a terrifying Lolly. As promised, I'll show you her ultimate Drago Buster, which, if you triple cast it while in your special transformation, with Holy Strike active and max overcharge, looks like this. And if you added full rage stacks, which is kind of an impossible thing to pull off, but still cool, it'd look like this. Could that destroy a city and the neighboring mountain? No, not really, but on a board with 5x5-inch squares, it's gonna really feel like it. But let me know if you guys have an idea for how you would make a better version of Milam. Did I forget anything? Let me know in the comments below. If you like this video, you know what to do. Hit that like and subscribe button. If you want to grab a free version of the current game and its supplements, head on over to worldsofmyth.net. Also, head on over to our Facebook and Discord groups if you want to find a group to play with. And until next time, my beautiful weebs, peace.